God, grant us the serenity to accept the things we cannot change, courage to change the things we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Amen. Paul is writing this morning to the church in Philippi, a group of people who he helped to spread the faith to, that he helped to organize and to found their community of faith there. And he gets word that they are divided, that they're having difficulties in their community, and he's grieved. Paul himself is in prison as he writes this letter to the church. And he expresses to them, even from his place of suffering, how much they have to gain, how much he himself has gained in Christ. The suffering, even the joys, everything that he has attained in his life, he counts as loss because of the surpassing value of what he knows in his relationship with Jesus. It's something that has changed everything for him. For me, I think that the power of love, the quantity of love, can be measured not by how perfect or shiny or lovely it is, but by that which it stands against, by that which it can overcome. The love, the power of Christ is known, is shown forth in all its glory in relation to that which it can overcome. Paul, in extreme suffering in a prison cell, not knowing if he is going to die, and now being grieved by this community that he loves, and hearing news about what's going on in their midst, writes from a place filled with incredible joy and hope because of the power of God working in his heart. There's an image in the Gospel of John, the image of Christ as the light of the world. I imagine a single flickering candle, as the passage says, the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. You see, when we look at love, when we look at God's presence in our heart, it might look like just a flickering candle, like something weak and insignificant. But there is no quantity of darkness in this world, no quantity of sin or evil or separation from God or suffering which can snuff out that light. It might look insignificant, but love is more powerful than it all. Paul knows that. Paul is trying to communicate that with his words to this community that he loves. In this time of suffering, in our community, in our own lives, we might be tempted to think that God is punishing us. In our crying out to God, we might say, "Why are you doing this? Why are you seeking to discipline us? Or to force us to learn something new? Why is it that you are punishing us for what we've done?" But if we focus on that, we're getting it wrong. I do not believe that God sends suffering upon his children in order to teach them or discipline them or punish them or change them. God grieves at the suffering of the world. God grieves at our division and our pain. God weeps with us. And God comes alongside us, wraps God's own loving arms around us, encouraging us, holding us, transforming the nature of our suffering. Paul's suffering was transformed. It didn't go away. He was still in pain. He was still in anguish. He was still fearing for his life and probably weeping over the church in Philippi and the other churches that he was getting bad reports about. His suffering did not end because Christ was with him. But alongside that suffering came something else. Gratitude. Gratitude for the power of that love in his life and what it had done to transform him. How it had taken everything that he had ever achieved, and by the list in the reading today, it was quite a bit that he had to brag about. And all of that meant nothing compared to the gratitude that he had for the way that the love of Christ was moving in his heart and in his life. See, gratitude doesn't take away our grief. It doesn't take away our suffering, but it comes alongside it. We can be grateful. Grateful for the people that God has placed in our life in order that we might love them. Grateful for the way that we feel connected one to another, for the way that prayer has connected us, for the way that God's love and hope has come to us in unexpected times and places. Thankful that the winds have not been too strong. Thankful that the firefighters have made the progress that they have. Thankful for every glimmer of hope and good experience that we have each day. Thankful for our beating hearts, for the air in our lungs, even when it stings a little. Thankful that we are not alone. That gratitude comes alongside our suffering. We can experience both at the same time. And because we have both, one is transformed by the other. We are able, even in the midst of pain, to glimpse beyond the veil, to see the hope that exists, to see the way that God is present and active right now in our lives and in the world. How do we participate in that gratitude? How do we participate in God's love and what it's doing in the world? Part of what's so difficult and frustrating right now is that we feel helpless, like there's nothing that we can do. Sit and wait and watch as others suffer. But even when there's nothing active that we can be doing in order to reach out and love and serve, even when it feels like there is nothing, we can always pray. And like love, prayer can seem like a simple flickering candle in the face of an eternal darkness, as though our prayer will make no difference at all, as though it is nothing. Perhaps that's the temptation to turn us away from prayer. When in fact, prayer is the very means by which we connect to God. Prayer is the very means by which we experience our relationship with God. Prayer is the very means by which our hearts are opened to be a conduit of God's love, of God's peace, of God's hope, God's strength, God's presence in our own lives and in the world. When we pray, God helps carry our burdens, and God pours into us all it is that we need in order to follow Jesus, in order to let that love flow into the world. Prayer changes us. And when we pray for other people, we surround them with that same love, that same hope, that same peace, that same strength, everything that they need in order to be held, in order to take one more step, in order to, as Paul says today, press on in faith. And our prayers in that way become part of what God is doing in their life and in the world. Our prayers make a difference. Last week I talked about my time in Liberia and how there was a moment that I wanted to give up, but it was the prayers of the people that I knew were supporting me that kept me hanging in there, that kept me there so that I might learn. something new about love and about God's presence. And I bet each one of you at some point in your life have had other people praying for you, whether you knew it or not. And in that moment of difficulty, if you look back on it now, you might just see the way in which God's love and presence and hope and peace came to you perhaps in just the moment that you needed it. Not eliminating your suffering or pain or grief, but coming alongside it, holding your heart. I hope that each one of us has an experience like that in our memory, that we might be able to recall and remember that prayer changes us and that it changes the world. Sometimes we can feel like we can't pray because we don't have the right words. But God takes our prayer, whatever it is, whatever it sounds like, wherever we are, even if it's wordless, even if it's angry, even if it's weeping, God can take it. God can hold it. God accepts it with love as we turn our hearts to God, as we beat down the gates of heaven with our prayers. God hears. God weeps with us. God holds us. And if you really can't find any words at all, God receives your silence and God listens. Sometimes I open the book of Psalms, that ancient text full of honest prayers to God, prayers of rage and manipulation, prayers of sadness, prayers of joy, prayers of deep, deep longing. And as I pray those words, those ancient words that Jesus himself prayed, I am reminded that I am not alone in prayer. I'm connected to all of you who are praying, and I'm connected to the thousands of years of people who have sought to follow God, who earnestly lift up their hearts in prayer, whatever prayer might look like, who in their own way, in their own day, and in their own time, were a part of what God was doing in the world, way back then and today. And a reminder that the communion of saints, all of those people who have loved God, continue to pray for us, continue to surround and to hold us in their prayers. My prayer for you this week, friends, is that you might feel the prayers that are being prayed for you, surrounding you. I'm praying for you. This community is praying for you as you pray for them and for others. And that in whatever moments of prayer you find this week, you would feel yourself to be a conduit of God's love, God's hope, and God's peace, which is measured not by how shiny and perfect it might seem, but by that which it can stand against, that which it can overcome.